greetings. I have to state right up front, I was born again at 8 years of age, roughly 45 years ago, and only recently did I hear and study the teaching of the rapture. I was raised learning to be an overcomer. Revelation 2:17. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. To him that overcometh will I give to eat of the hidden manna, and will give him a white stone, and in the stone a new name written, which no man knows, saving he that receiveth it. Revelation 2:26. And he that overcometh and keepeth my works unto the end, to him will I give power over the nations. Revelations 3:5. He that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. This verse always makes me pause. Think about what Jesus says. I will not blot out his name out of the book of life. It implies the name is already in the book of life. To blot out is to remove what is already there. Just something to think about as you meditate. Look at other verses on the book of life. 1 John 4:4, you are of God, little children, and have overcome them, because greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. 1 John 5:4, for whatsoever is born of God overcometh the world. And this is the victory that overcomes the world, even our faith. So until I was nearly 50, my heart and belief was overcoming. And that included a balanced application of the faith message. Then I began to hear and read about the rapture, but not with any presupposed bias for the idea. If asked, I probably would have painted it as escapism, with a chaser of pity for the poor, unprepared folks who did not escape. Maybe some of you can relate to those feelings and perceptions. But over the last 7 to 10 years, I examined rapture scriptures in parallel as I studied Mohammedism. And my conviction that the rapture would happen is nearly as strong as my unshakable realization that Mohammedism is the religion of Antichrist. And it addressed an imagery I never felt I heard adequately explained. The Bride of Christ. A topic that very few ever address is the intersection and interaction of the Bride of Christ and the Body of Christ. I'm sure many of you are just sure you've got the final answer. I'm happy for you if you are absolutely confident, but I just never had peace in my knowledge. Until I began to very seriously consider the rapture in my worldview. But even then, more issues arose from the scriptures. Luke 21:36. Watch you, therefore, and pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass, and to stand before the Son of Man. I admit that verse was and is troubling. It implies not all will be worthy. Pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things. Worthy to escape. That verse all alone should undermine callow certainty. You pray always that you may be accounted worthy to escape all these things that shall come to pass. So if you reject the idea of the rapture, what plausible interpretation can rationally be given for that verse? Give that serious thought and critically judge whatever rationale you contrive. If you think it is weaker than the obvious reading of the clear text, you probably have your answer without asking. Let's not accuse Mohammedans of willful ignorance and then adopt the behavior ourselves, all right? So the first consideration that nudged me was the bride of Christ. The second would have to be the feasts of the Lord. In particular, the pattern of those fulfilled, and when they were fulfilled, and those that remain. Those that remain are the Feast of Trumpets, the Feast of Atonement, and the Feast of Tabernacles. I am constantly aware of how and when the first four were fulfilled. By Jesus, in order, during the feasts. And a phrase from a verse almost haunts me, so that they are without excuse. I know that applies specifically to a different context. Romans 1:20, for the invisible things of him from the creation of the world are clearly seen, being understood by the things that are made, even his eternal power and Godhead, so that they are without excuse. The feasts of the Lord depict a specific sequence. A sequence fulfilled in order, mind you, on the day of the very feast it associates with. That's like a golfer with four hole-in-ones on four successive holes. But skeptics are looking for a reason, an excuse, to not believe. And I have a real sincere inkling that God is leaving them no excuse. The third factor would be when I finally began objectively looking at the scriptures themselves. I believe the issue arises from an either-or mentality, a false choice that assumes one event and forces scripture to fit that assumption. So in the next video, I will examine a list of scriptures and attempt to review them from both perspectives if possible. Now, I titled this video, Why I Expect the Rapture. That does not mean I am setting a date, nor am I committing any action that is irrevocable. Please do not extrapolate that to mean I'm going wisenant. I'll explain that reference for you if it didn't ring a bell. In 1987, Edgar Wisenant wrote 88 Reasons the Rapture Will Occur in 1988. We're here because he was wrong. It didn't happen. My faith is not based on a rapture. I'm still an overcomer. So should you be too. Be prepared. I will review a specific list of scriptures in the next video. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light, your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.